And now it's my pleasure to introduce a great friend and advocate for our region, Congressman Dan Newhouse, who represents Washington's 4th District. Congressman Newhouse is a longtime proponent for our state, previously serving 4 terms in the Washington State House of Representatives and as director of the State Department of Agriculture. As a third-generation farmer and businessman in the Yakima Valley, Dan is a neighbor with deep roots in central Washington who brings his firsthand understanding of our area's priorities and issues to Congress. And he does so effectively through his service on the House Committee on Appropriations, specifically the subcommittees on energy and water development, agricultural rural development and the FDA, and the legislative branch. These are important committee assignments that reflect both his influence and the respect he commands from his colleagues and House leadership. He also serves as chairman of the Congressional Western Caucus, whose 60 members across the U.S. are working to address rural policy issues in several important areas, including economic growth and energy security. And we were pleased to host the congressman and several of his colleagues from the caucus earlier this year to discuss energy policy. Congressman Newhouse co-chairs several additional caucuses on topics impacting our community, from wine and fertilizer to salmon and nuclear waste cleanup. You have very interesting days, I imagine. Congressman Newhouse's strong support of our community is evident in the work that he does every day on our behalf in the House of Representatives to address critical challenges affecting our district. He advocates for our veterans and farmers, champions new ways to develop a future workforce, and of course is instrumental in securing funding for P&L and the Hanford cleanup. Congressman Newhouse's advocacy and hard work is contributing to our community's growth and the nation's economic prosperity and security. It's an honor to have him with us today, so please join me in a round of applause for a warm welcome for Congressman Dan Newhouse.
Thank you very much, Steve. It's good to be with you this afternoon. Those of you that were here a couple years ago, I think it was, remember that I showed up in just jeans and my farm clothes. And I think it was a clean shirt at least, but we were picking hops at the time, and I figured I don't have time to run home and change, and then when I get back, do it again. So I just came as I was from the hop kill. We're going to start tomorrow, so it's worked. I don't usually wear this to pick hops, but I could. But pleasure to be here at least with you with clean jeans on. Thanks for that introduction, Steve. Pleasure to be with all of you. Thanks for getting most everything I'm working on in Congress. Actually, the Western Caucus has 80 members in it, so I'm very happy about that. And I noticed I probably will miss somebody, but you're introducing everybody in the room, and if I could introduce, first of all, my district director, Ashley Stubbs, is here somewhere. She's running around with a camera. Oh, there she is, right there. But I saw at least 2 of former staff members. Josh Lozano is over here, right there, Josh. And Jason Herbert. I saw Jason out talking on his phone in the parking lot. I don't know if he made it into the room or not. Oh, there he is, Jason. Any other staffers here? I can't see everybody, but pleasure to have you guys in the room. So I think, at least if my notes are correct, right, before I get started, we have an annual tradition that I kind of half reluctantly agreed to participate in. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Mr. Andy Sterling, who is the board chair and of the chamber, and have him take it from here. Andy.
All right. Not sure it was a good idea to give me a wireless mic, but we'll see how it goes.
See how it, yeah.
All right, so we're gonna play a little game with you, and so you may be more reluctant next year to do this, so we'll see. If I could get everybody to stand up, we're gonna do a little Congressman Newhouse version of Heads and Tails today. All right, so what we're gonna do is Congressman Newhouse trivia today. So I'm gonna ask him a question. If the question is true or you think it's true, put your hand on your head. If you think it's false, put your hand on your hips or your tail, your preference. And keep your hands to yourself. I should probably add that. All right. Okay. And actually, we're going to take this all the way down to one person, where one lucky winner is going to win a $50 gift card to Ice Harbor Brewing. Oh, wow. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. Yeah, I was about to. I had that in my notes. You just.
I'm disqualified.
Yeah, you're disqualified, and I suppose I am too, since we know the answers. All right, first question. Dan has one dog, two cats, and three bison. Is that true or false? Hand on your head if it's true, hand on your tail if it's false. All right, I think we're ready for the answer.
Oh, you want me to give it?
Yeah, you bet.
So, gosh, I'm going to be unpopular here. We do have one dog at home, and we have a stray cat that makes two, but it's more like a dozen in the herd of bison right now, so sorry.
Yeah, how much for a ticket? We got Newhouse National Park over here.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Next question. Wow, that really stirred up some conversation. I like it. Yeah, 12 bison. This is the eighth time Dan has spoken at the annual congressional update for the regional chamber. This is the eighth time. True head, false tail. Oh, doubling up. All right, is that true or false?
So I wasn't going to be able to answer this one, but I think it's the eighth time. You tell me.
That is correct. This is the eighth time. True. Way to double down over here. Okay. Let me ask the question. Actually, for those that are still in it, will you start making your way to the front here? We're going to do this as if I'm Camille Booker, but just slightly slower. Slowly make your way to the front. Come on up, guys. This is big money here.
Yeah,
that's exactly right. That is exactly right. And then we've got a coin.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, look at this. Nice. Yeah, this is good. Now we kind of have an audit committee out there. Okay. Now, I really, really, really want this next one to be true. Dan's first car was a Pinto. Dan's first car was a Pinto. The tails, I think if you rammed into one of those, they didn't survive very well. Okay.
So we were a Ford family, that's true, but my first car was a Chevy Camaro. I didn't get out.
Some good sportsmanship. Sorry. This was meant to make it more popular, and I'm not sure if we're doing that.
No, all right.
Yeah, I apologize. All right. Is Jason out? Jason's already out, huh? Okay, all right. I was wondering how we didn't see him up here. Okay, I'm going to switch these up. Dan is a proud graduate of Washington State University. So there are graduates from WSU. I just want to point that out. Okay, all right. Okay. All right, Dan, is that true or false?
This is Cougar Country. Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
All right, let's hear them. There. That's great. All right, did we keep everybody? We didn't lose anybody, huh?
Oh, wow.
All right. And just so you know, this may come down to a quarter flip, and we're prepared for that. Dan was a member of a fraternity at WSU, as you now know. The at WSU part was added. That was me. So the fraternity part is the real question here. Okay. Oh, we got it split a little bit. All right. Congressman?
Sure. So, AGR is a fraternity that you have to be an agricultural major to be a part of, and I was in AGR, yes. Alpha Gamma Rho.
Nice. All right. I know, especially because I think he gave their last one away.
Maybe.
All right. So this may have been given away earlier when Congressman Newhouse came up on stage, but his favorite crop to grow is hops.
Now, if you ask me this question in about a month from now, you get so sick of seeing hops that you probably, it's not your favorite. But yes, hops are in my blood, and not just because I drink beer either. Yeah.
So I'm going to ask a question, and I believe this is correct. Another crop that Congressman Newhouse grows are grapes.
That is true. We live, actually, my house is in a field of Cabernet.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So unless you have a bonus question, we might have to go to the quarter.
Yeah, I got nothing. I don't know.
All right. So the quarter it is. Perfect. So if you want to flip it. Yeah, I know. I was going to do it, but it'll go everywhere.
I have to catch it, too.
Yeah, you do. Oh. Before we reveal, heads or tails? Heads on your head, clearly. Tails on your, tail.
So
are you heads or tails?
He's contemplating.
I like it. Tails, okay. Congressman?
So if you got your hands on your tails, it's a tail, what are you?
You are still alive.
Okay, it's heads.
Heads. Okay, what do we have?
We're done.
Oh.
That worked.
Down to the final three for a $50 Ice Harbor gift card. Let's see. Okay. Yeah, go for it. Let's do it. All right.
Drum roll, please.
Okay. Hand on your head.
You got potentially a winner.
Okay, we're ready to go. Heads it is. All right, the final one.
Do I get to keep the quarter?
No, we absolutely not. Okay, we need one more.
Oh, gosh.
All right, you guys, where you want to be?
We got one of each. So
one
somebody,
of each. This is perfect. And it's... Tails! Tails is our winner. I like that. Congratulations. Here we go. All right. I'm going to get out of your hair. Thanks so much for doing that with us.
Absolutely, Andy. Thank you. Fun. Awesome. Well, now you know a little bit about more about me, maybe more than you cared to. But, I'm born and raised on a farm. We are now in our fourth, working on our fifth generation. So, in fact, we just celebrated my grandfather a couple years ago. We celebrated 100 years since he came over and bought his first land. So very proud of that fact. So this is a congressional update opportunity. I've got a ton of things that I could talk to you about. There really are so many things happening in our country today. Some great, some not so great, but no one can say we don't live in interesting times, can they? A lot of challenges out there, a lot of opportunities, I think, in our country and in the world. But we've got to keep our nose to the grindstone. We've got to pay attention to what's happening, and we've got to be engaged in the process. So I'm really happy to be here with you to talk about a few of those things. Also, I think Lori mentioned if we have time for some questions at the end, I'd certainly like to hear what's on your mind as well. So where to start? Anybody notice the price of things going up lately? Yeah, the price of almost everything is going up. But we are, I'm told, and I'm sure you've heard this too, we are experiencing inflation that's higher than it's been in 40 years. And the bad thing about that is I remember the last time it was at this point. In fact, back in the 70s and early 80s, interest rates climbed to almost 20%, which as a farmer, when you have to borrow money to operate, that is killer interest rates. I hope and pray that we don't get back to those rates again. Any bankers in the room, can you assure us that's not going to happen? That will be devastating, not just for farmers, but for everybody. If you want to buy a home, you want to buy a car, small businesses, large businesses, let's hope we can fend that off. You know, recently Congress passed something that's called the Inflation Reduction Act, and one of the few things I can say about that is some of the staff that are here know this, but we come up with some very clever names for pieces of legislation. This one in particular, somebody was really using their imagination, because I don't think even economic experts predict that this is going to do anything to reduce inflation in the near term, and maybe not even in the long term. So the jury's still out on that. But what it will impact are the taxes we all pay, particularly if you're a manufacturer. The National Association of Manufacturers predicts that over 200,000 jobs will be lost because of the increase in the amount of taxes that manufacturers will have to pay. And you know how obviously companies always absorb increases in taxes, right? They never pass them on to the consumer. So we can all feel comfortable about that, right? Being a little sarcastic probably, but you can rest assured that taxes are going to impact everybody, which is not something that we've been told was going to happen in this administration. So I'm a little bit confused as to why we're going this direction. I can't tell you there's nothing good in this bill. As with any piece of legislation, it's usually a mixture of good and bad. But in these inflationary times, which we just talked about, one thing that I learned at WSU, Andy, that I did go to class once in a while, but Economics 101 teaches you, when you put more money into the economy, particularly from the federal government, right, guess what's going to happen? You're going to see inflation. And this is just another example of us as the federal government doing that. Which is going to make life more difficult for everyone. You know, one of the things that I've been working on, just so you know this, Steve mentioned that I was chairman of the Western Caucus. In fact, I was just in the state of Montana a week ago, talking about some of the energy issues, leading an event there that we were looking at some of the things that we as a country have opportunities that we can work on that will help the rising cost of everything, that will help decrease inflation. And one of those drivers, as you well know, is energy. It takes energy to do everything, to do anything. And when energy costs are high, costs of goods and services are going to be high. One of the things that I try to simplify, you know, we have a tremendous amount of natural resources in our country, but we also have a federal government that's making it more and more difficult for us as Americans to take advantage of the resources that we have, and causing us to have to rely on foreign sources for particularly oil and gas, because fossil fuels have been deemed evil. And certainly we want to take care of our environment and improve our climate. With hotter summers every year, we all see evidence of reasons to do that. But the thing that I try to remind people is we cannot flip a switch from fossil fuels to alternative sources of energy and change in the blink of an eye. It has to be a gradual change. My guess, my estimate, my prediction, that everybody in this room will still be alive and we will still be using fossil fuels on into the future. The good thing is we'll be making transitions if we let the market do its thing and not have the government force this change. It's just going to raise costs of energy for everybody. But the good thing is, too, is that we in the United States, we not only can secure these necessary energy sources, but we do it safer environmentally, we do it cleaner, more responsibly than anywhere else in the world. And some of the sources that we have are actually cleaner sources of energy than other places in the world. And so, you know, I'm not one of those that's a climate change denier by any means, but I do think that we can move forward responsibly utilizing those energy resources that we have in this country, keep the cost of business down by not forcing people to rely on foreign sources that would dramatically, negatively impact our economy. We can have a clean energy future, but a vibrant economy at the same time. They're not mutually exclusive. So that's something that I've been helping introduce legislation to make that happen, to allow us to do exactly that. You know, speaking of energy, we have, as you know, in the Pacific Northwest, we are blessed with many different clean sources of energy that we should be encouraging, not only nuclear, wind and solar. Those things absolutely we are blessed to have a kind of environment that works in. But one of the things, and I know it's kind of like preaching to the choir, because I remember one of the survey questions several years ago asked about the hydroelectric dams on the Snake and the Columbia Rivers. Vitally important pieces of infrastructure to our region, to our state, to our country. And as you know, the forces, the rhetoric, the pressure to remove, to start with, 1, 2, 3, or maybe all 4 of the lower Snake River dams is high. In fact, it's higher than I've ever seen it, higher than my almost 8 years now in Congress. You know, there's always been, ever since I think the dams were constructed, there's always been people that say that this was a mistake. But I think we've been able to show that we can benefit from the dams, from all of the things that they provide for us in the way of increased agriculture and transportation, and clean, carbon-free power production, all of those things that we benefit from that have truly transformed our region, while salmon can thrive. Have you seen the numbers recently for the return, the number of salmon returning over the spring and summer? It's tremendous, which proves to me that dams and salmon can and do coexist, something I've been trying to say for years now. But we do have a tremendous challenge there. In fact, it could be today, but maybe tomorrow, that the results, or I should say the conclusions of the Inslee and Murray effort to study how we can mitigate for the loss of the dams will be coming out. I don't know what that report is going to say. My guess is that it's going to recommend taking out at least one of the dams, which, you know, if you do one, you've just ruined the transportation system that we have that allows Lewiston and Clarkston to be ocean ports, that over 50% of the wheat produced in the United States travels down the river. What a huge impact that would have. Mixed feelings about saying this, but any of you from South Dakota, by the way, have friends or family there? Beautiful place. I've got family that live in western South Dakota. In fact, if you go there, it kind of reminds me of eastern Washington. Great people, hardworking, industrious, but you know the one thing they don't have? Water. Our eastern Washington would be just like South Dakota if we didn't have those dams. So instead of eliminating the advantage that we have, that Mother Nature, that God gave us, that has allowed our economy to prosper in such a huge way, it just seems contrary to common sense that we would do something as drastic and as dire as what's being talked about, and what I think perhaps our governor and our senator are going to recommend. So my charge to all of you, every single one of you, is please don't fall into this, which I've seen. In fact, several people have told me, that idea is so crazy, it's never gonna happen. Newhouse, just shut up about it, because it's not happening. Well, guess what? It could easily happen. It could easily happen. It's now a bipartisan effort in the U.S. Congress. We have Republicans and Democrats, and it's a congressional decision. It absolutely is. So that should give you some comfort, right? Even the White House has come out with a report saying, yes, breaching a dam makes sense. So please stay ever vigilant on making sure that we can continue to enjoy the benefits from the Lower Snake River dams. And don't be comfortable in thinking that, oh, if they take those, well, we still have all the rest of them. Well, guess what? If one goes, every single one of the other dams, even the PUD-controlled dams, are at risk. And we could lose it all. And I don't think any of us want to see that happen. In fact, I can make this pledge to you. It will not happen while I'm in the U.S. Congress. And I need your help to make sure that I'm telling the truth. Thank you. There's a lot of other things I could talk about, and just a couple things I want to mention. You wouldn't know this in the Tri-Cities, but there's a housing crisis in the state of Washington. And even in the Tri-Cities, there's a lot of people that can't afford homes. What's the, some of your realtors in the room, what's the average cost of a new home in the Tri-Cities today? Was that $476,000? Hi. We're number one at something as far as the state is concerned. Let's see if I can, I don't want to misstate this. We have the fewest housing units available per family household in the nation. We're number one. Yeah. The costs of building a home, because of all the regulation and the extra steps that we force builders to go through, has added demonstrably to the cost of construction. I can't remember this number. Maybe some of you realtors would remember it for me. Every $1,000 that a cost of a home goes up, you eliminate from the potential market X number of people. It becomes out of their price range. An average of $26,000 extra dollars is on that cost of a home because of rules and regulations. I think we need to make it simpler. Unfetter the housing industry so that we can get more people into houses that make it more affordable for people. You know, we can work on a lot of other things, absolutely. We need to do that, make sure there's jobs available. In the Tri-Cities, there's a lot of jobs available. In fact, we don't have enough people to fill the jobs that are available. But housing throughout the state of Washington is a huge issue. Another thing that typically when I drive here to address you for the congressional update, I have to navigate, and you do too, through a cloud of smoke, because it's a time of year that we have the catastrophic wildfires that we've almost gotten too used to. Fortunately, so far, yes, we've had some fires, but not to the catastrophic nature that we typically do. There's still a lot of time left, so I'm probably jinxing it by even bringing it up. But just to remind you, Congress has a huge amount of work to do in this area. We've been doing some things and making progress, but if any of you have taken a trip through any of our national forests lately, you know what I'm talking about. The condition of our forests is not good, and we need to do all we can to make sure the Forest Service does the management work that's necessary to make sure that these fires that are inevitable don't turn into the catastrophic nature that, you know, talking about clean energy future, gosh, the amount of CO2 that's put into the atmosphere because of a large fire is tremendous. Just a couple of weeks ago, the smoke that we saw, I was told, up here in Washington was from the big fires down in California. We get it from British Columbia. We get it from Idaho and Wyoming and Colorado. It seems to all come here for some reason. But fortunately, this year, we don't have so far those fires in our state as to the extent that we typically do. But that's another thing that the federal government has to continue working on. You know what? Another issue that's near and dear to my heart, not just raising hops, but agriculture in general, I truly am one of my biggest priorities in Congress. It's making sure the agricultural economy remains strong. And, you know, part of that is making sure we have a legal workforce. Here in our state, we see the necessity of having people to perform the tasks that are necessary in our labor-intensive production of crops. You know, hops is a great example, but there's so many other things that we depend on people to come in here and do. But we want a legal workforce, right? We don't want an illegal workforce forcing people to have to pay coyotes to get them across the border in a very dangerous way. And so I've been working very hard on something called the Farm Workforce Modernization Act. It's now passed the House of Representatives twice, which I'm very proud about that, because the last time any major piece of immigration legislation passed the U.S. Congress was in 1986. It's been a long time. It has usually been held up in the Senate. The good news is, and I understand the senator is in town this afternoon. If anybody's going to be meeting with her, you could bring this up. The good news is it's getting momentum in the Senate this year. And my hope is that we can get the legislation passed and signed into law still in this calendar year, in this Congress. Our farmers need help. Our border needs help. It needs securing. We need to reduce the incentive for people to come here illegally. And by passing laws like this, we'll absolutely do that. So we can get a couple of those birds with one stone if we can pass common sense legislation like the Farm Workforce Modernization Act. Another thing to protect agriculture, and maybe some of you have seen this in the news, and this is bigger than just agriculture, but the country of China, the People's Republic of China, anybody heard about the Belts and Roads Initiative? They have been engaged in embarking on this effort across the globe to secure natural resource assets. They're building things all over the world. They're buying up land in other countries to produce food, to control food production to come into their country, because China can't raise enough on their own. Well, guess what? They're doing that here in the United States as well. The amount of farmland that the People's Republic of China and companies associated with the PRC has grown tenfold over the last decade in our country. And so I'm proud about this. Twice now I have gotten an amendment to the appropriations process, through the appropriations process to the spending bill, language to make it illegal for China, communist China, to purchase agricultural land in the United States. I got that passed on a unanimous vote in committee. People say nothing happens in a bipartisan way in the United States Congress. That's absolutely not true. We can get some things done. We haven't made it into law yet. We've got to get that done. But we're working hard on that. And this is something that some people have told me, well, it's not that much land yet. They only own a few hundred thousand acres. But like I said, it's growing. Their goals, if you look at what they've been doing around the world, are huge. They've got a huge population to feed. This is, if we let any country, let alone a country that's not our friend and ally, have a large stake in and control of our food production, that's in my mind, not only a food security issue, that becomes all of a sudden a national security issue. So we're going to keep working very hard on that to make sure that actually becomes law as well. Now, not just because Steve introduced me, but I can't sit down without saying something about Hanford and the National Laboratory. Certainly, the Hanford cleanup is continuing. The cost of that is huge, as you know. But it's important work that the federal government is engaged in there. There's not only a legal obligation on the part of the federal government, but it's truly a moral obligation that our government has to make sure that work gets done. And so it's a huge priority of mine to educate members of Congress as to why we have to continue to write that big check that comes to Richland, Washington, every single year. I wish it was that easy, just one check, but it's not. So, and we're making, there's some exciting progress that's going to be reported here soon about the steps that are happening in that cleanup process. So we'll continue to work on. That's why I'm part of the Nuclear Cleanup Caucus, to make sure that, you know, after that meeting, we need to go over to the Wine Caucus in order to unwind a little bit. But part of my responsibility as your representative is to make sure people in other parts of the country understand what's going on. Otherwise, that money won't keep coming here. If people don't get how important it is, how important the Columbia River is, how important it is to get those darn tanks emptied and to put into safe storage the material that's being stored in them. So we'll continue to work very hard on that and make sure that happens as well. And then every time I go to the lab, there's always something else that I learn exciting that's going on out there. That's what, 5,700 employees. Have all of you been to, I know you've heard of the laboratory. All of you been out to the laboratory? You wanted more guests, right? More visitors? If you haven't, if there's opportunities to see and to learn and to go to see firsthand what's happening at the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, right in your own backyard, which is something that I bet you if you walk down, go into the Columbia Center Mall and ask just the person walking around the hallways if they know anything about the lab, you might get a blank stare back. A lot of people don't understand how significant it is, the accomplishments and the things that are not only have been accomplished, but are continued to be worked on, that are going to be so important for our future here in the Tri-Cities and in Washington, but I would say not the country and the world, the things that are being worked on there. The grid storage launch pad is a great example of that, but there are so many places that the lab leads the way in producing vital research that that our country will benefit from for decades, for lifetimes to come. So thank you, Steve, and for all your team for everything that you do out there. It's just awesome. And so, gosh, a little bit of an impromptu presentation. I've got some notes my staff is very good about putting together and helping me remember important things. So many different things that we could talk about, though. You know, veterans, I think Steve mentioned veterans. You know, we have a lot of veterans in Central Washington. We do, and we owe them a great deal. Some of the things going on right now in the VA should concern every single one of you. If you heard about the switch over to electronic record keeping that the VA is engaged in, well, guess what? Spokane and Walla Walla, we're the guinea pigs here in Richland. This is the test case for the whole country. They decided to pick our area to figure out how to do this record keeping. And the money that was appropriated for them to do this, for all, gosh, how many are there? There's, I've forgotten the numbers. I want to say 285. That may not be right. Of facilities across the country, they've already burned through half the money just in Eastern Washington. And it's been a fiasco, to tell you the truth. The cases that have put at risk veterans is concerning, to say the least. And so continue to watch for developments there on how we can get that fixed so that we don't compromise veterans when they're seeking medical care, that we get this system turned around and straightened out so before it's rolled out across the country. So that's one of the, I've had several people come here to our district to learn, to see firsthand what's happening, and so that we can find a solution for the VA system that they're trying to change over to. You know, I could talk a little bit about, there's a lot of issues about crime, about illegal drugs, about, you know, one of the concerning things to me, and you guys probably have heard this number, do you know what the leading cause of death for people between 18 and 45 is? Drug overdose. I mean, if that doesn't make you concerned, nothing will. The fentanyl, and now there's other things the drug makers are coming up with that is even stronger and more deadly than that. are literally killing Americans every single day. And don't think Central Washington is immune from it. We seem to be at a crossroads, several highways coming together in Central Washington. So we are definitely in the thick of it, in the middle of it. And it's killing our friends and our neighbors, people we love. And this is a huge issue across the country. It's something we have to, that's another reason we have to get control of our southern border, because that's where a lot of it's coming from. But there's a lot of things we can talk about, a lot of issues. I don't want to be negative and pessimistic, because I'm a very optimistic person. I still think we live in the greatest country in the world. We have challenges, we do, but we have a lot of great people that will step up to these challenges and make sure that we're successful on into the future. And many of them are sitting in this very room. When you put a Chamber of Commerce together and you get such a turnout on a regular basis to make sure that our business community is strong, that our communities are strong, that people are engaged, that gives you hope for the future. It really does. So thank you, Lori. Thank you, Andy. Thank you, Steve. And thank all of you for having me today. It's always an honor and a pleasure to visit with you, but also, let me tell you for sure, to represent you in Washington, D.C. It's a huge honor, one with a huge responsibility, but a huge honor to be your voice in Washington, D.C. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.